Hey everyone, the main surveyor here. Let's talk about the Wild T2 Theodolite. So I've had it on a couple of videos recently, and I thought it'd be fun to go through what it's all about a little bit more. So I just bought one earlier this year. I haven't had a chance to use it a whole lot, this unit right here. It was built in about 1969, 1970, more or less, going by the serial number there. And it's pretty fun to use. You have to think about what you're doing while you use it. And if you're coming from the digital world like I am, so I'm used to digital total stations. And though they operate on similar principles, they have a horizontal circle, they have a vertical circle. You turn angles in both of those axes and point the scope at the target and read the angles, just like you would with a total station. There are some subtleties that one must be careful to take note of when setting this up and operating it. And so I had a video the other day, and I pointed the scope at 90 degrees, what read 90 degrees, and Larry Scott's like, well, it's interesting that you have that set up with your auto level and just see what the differences are and the similarities. But that's not really, what we do with a Theodolite. And fair enough. So this is a learning experience for me. And I'm going to invite you, the audience, to come and learn with me about this Theodolite and how to use it. So, in anything that I say, Larry, if I make any mistakes, please chime in the comments and offer corrections as necessary. Or Jesse Kozlowski can say, where I might not have quite the right understanding, that's fine. And anybody else in the audience that has used either a T2 or a similar kind of theodolite, mechanical theodolite that operates on the same principles as this unit here, please chime in. I'm a willing student and would like to know all I can about this. And that's the fun part, right? Learning how to operate your equipment. I bought a bass guitar a few months ago and it needed to be set up. Now, if you play guitars, you understand what the term set up means. And I wasn't going to pay some guitar tech $100, $200 to set up my electric bass for me. Like, I can do this. So I spent a few hours online researching how do we set up an instrument. And I had a lot of fun. I went and bought the specific tools I needed to have and set up my bass guitar. And man, that thing, the intonation's amazing now, plays very well. And I would like to do the similar, the corollary to that with the Theodolite. I want to learn everything I can about this Theodolite. I want to be able to maintain this Theodolite and operate it efficiently. Okay, so the first thing to do is go right to the horse's mouth, right? So here is the instructions for use from the company Wild Heerbrug, which doesn't really actually exist anymore. I think they were bought out by Leica, I want to say. Correct me if I'm wrong. So Wild Heerbrug doesn't necessarily exist anymore per se. And the model is model 1956, even though mine was built in the late 60s, early 70s. And there's a few different models. There's this site, the Virtual Archive of Wild Heerbrug. This is a pretty cool site. So this is the modern T2, which came out in the mid 70s. Jesse Kozlowski has one like this. He may have one of the model 1956s as well. I'm not sure. This site is calling T21. It doesn't say T21 on mine, but nonetheless, this is what they mean. And then there's this older version, but that's pretty cool, all black and white. It's more or less the same thing, just the layout seems to be a bit different for some of the knobs and controls and whatnot. And so I'll put this link down in the description and you can check it out. So we come back to the manual and it tells you about the different parts. Now, the first thing about this manual is it's a little complicated at first. It reads kind of like stereo instructions. I don't know if you remember the movie Beetlejuice, and there's the handbook for the recently diseased. I'm sorry, I mean deceased. And the joke is it reads like stereo instructions. It's so hard to understand. So coming into this for the first time, parts that are a little bit different than on a total station, like, wait, what? That does what? And it calls the same object different things throughout the manual. So you really have to be clear on the context clues when you're reading this manual to figure out what's going on and how to be informed. So one of the important things to note is number 18 here. This is the optical micrometer knob, and this helps you read the angles through the microscope here. Number 21, the eyepiece for the reading microscope. And then this is the vertical circle housing, this larger circle on the side. This is the horizontal circle housing down here. And there is a chart for, let's see, how the light passes through. So the light comes in this side. You can have a mirror, or there's a light system where you can plug in a light, and there's like a, I think, a battery pack, I believe. Larry, correct me if I'm wrong. You use this setup quite a bit. I think it attaches to the tripod. And instead of having to rely on getting the mirror at the right angle to get the sunlight in there, which it can blind you, I found out pretty quickly. If you have it angled right at the sun and right in here, it's very bright very quickly. Don't do that. So Larry maintains the constant light, lighting through the horizontal and vertical circles. And so when he reads it through a microscope, it's consistent. The lighting doesn't have to play around with the mirrors. And one of the mirrors on mine is loose, and it's like, oh, I have to hold it so I can get the reflection right. And that's not a lot of fun. But apparently they pop off, and I'm going to switch the horizontal for the vertical mirror, and then because that one's tighter and it stays when you place it. There must be some little spring or something in there that keeps that from happening. The Army has a manual, a service manual on this that tells you how to take it apart and maintain all the pieces and whatnot and put it back together, which I am not going to go that extreme with it. But maybe if I had a one that was run down and only good for parts, I would take it apart and explore the interior of the thing. It's a way to screw it up real fast, for me anyway. So that's kind of neat. The light takes all these different paths through the instrument. And the primary application of it is triangulation. You can also use it for traverse and distance measuring and astronomic observations. That's really cool stuff. Let's see. It says the accuracy of angle measurement allows you to measure triangles with measured lateral lengths up to 10 miles. Well, that's for the second order. If you want to do, you want to get away with lower order triangulation, then keep using this because you're only limited by what you can see, right? So if you can see a target that's 100 miles away, well then you can use it. If you can turn to it twice in phase one and phase two, the same point, you might not be at second order triangulation at that point. Hey, what does that mean anyway? All these different orders. Let's look at the standards and specifications for geodetic networks. First order, the minimum distance accuracy, 1 in 10,000. So for layman, that's every 100,000 feet that you go, more or less. I mean, I'm really simplifying this. You could be off by up to a foot. Second order class two, 1 in 50,000. Class one is 1 in 50,000, class two is 1 in 20,000, third order class one is 1 in 10,000, and third order class two is 1 in 5,000. So the average boundary surveyor is working within this area, third order class one and class two, as a minimum. But with the equipment that we have today, a lot of survey traverses for boundary surveys will close out in raw. Over 150,000. So a lot of total stations today are already operating first and second order out of the box, as long as the crew is experienced and takes the right operates in the right procedures. Now, the rock loader can be really high, which is, pretty cool. But that's what that means. That's what the manual's referring to. So if you want to use it for second order triangulation, you can absolutely do that if you keep the legs of the triangles around 10 miles. And the Army did a extensive evaluation of the T2 in the 60s, and they had legs over 10 miles, almost 12 miles here in this area, in doing their test of the theodolite, and they do a great, really good job. And I'll link this in the description as well. And has instructions for use here, and all sorts of good stuff. And now I'm going to show you reading the circle. So this is for grads here on the right, which mine is not graduated and grads. Mine is graduate, and sometimes people say gons. Mine is graduated in 360 degrees. So degrees, minutes, and seconds. And this shows you how to read it. So when you look through that little microscope, this is what you're looking at. And actually looks a little bit closer to the eye. It looks more like that when you're looking at it. And so you read this part of the, oh, first what happens is you have a row of lines here and you have a row of lines here, and they don't line up. And you operate that knob on the side right here. This is for the micrometer scale. So you turn this until all of those lines are coincident. That means that they line up. But it's the technical term for lining them up. So once all these lines are in coincidence, then you can read your angle. So we read this scale. This is the whole number of degrees from left to right. So this line right here is less than 286. It's between 285 and 286. That means we at least have 285 degrees. Now, for reading the minutes, we go to the top scale and we read from right to left. We see 105 there, 106 there. Now, these big gaps are gaps of 20 minutes. So half of that would be 10, and the teens up to 20. 20 to 30 would be here, 30 to 40 would be here, 40 to 50, and 50 to 60, the next degree. So it's about halfway through, halfway between. This line and this line, that means we're at 50 minutes at least. Then we come down to the lower scale and we see that there's the whole number one, and then we come up to two. We're reading from left to right and we're between the one and the two, so we're going to add that one to the 50. So we're at 51 minutes. And then this hair right here is where we're going to read from. They're reading it as a little bit more than halfway between 54 and 55. So they're estimating it to be 54.6 seconds. It's definitely 54 seconds plus a little more, and they estimate it to be 0.6. Okay? So you can estimate the tenth of a second of angle. And it looks the same for both the vertical and horizontal circles. They both read the same way. All right, let's zoom out a little bit. Yeah, so here's the vertical circle reading, right? So the vertical circle, it's at least 94 degrees, and then it's about halfway between these two hash marks from 274 to 275, so it's at least 10 minutes. And then down here at the number scale at the bottom, we add the 2 to the 10, so that's 12. So we're at 12 minutes. And then we're at 40, between 43 and 44. So we're at 43.6, they say. That's what they came up with. And I concur. Of course, I concur. It doesn't matter if I agree or not. That's how it works. That's how you read the circle. So they're just showing you the vertical as well. And this would mean that you're looking downhill more or less. Now, let's see. We want to go to adjustments. Actually, let me go back up to the picture of the analyte. There's one important feature on this that I want to point out. And that is number 9, which is the level prism. You're like, okay, level prism. Yeah, what's that mean? So this is for vertical collimation. It's also sometimes called index error bubble or something like that. This helps you get a much more accurate vertical reading. So you point the scope, right, at the target. Before you even look in the microscope, you're going to look in this bubble. So the bubble is split in half, so it's reflected. And you're going to turn a knob, looks like this one, but it's on the other side of the unit. It's on the face two side. And you're going to turn that until the two halves of the bubble are coincident. Remember we talked about that term, coincident. You're going to line up both halves so it looks like one bubble. And when you've got that, then you are level and ready to read your microscope reading. So you look at the microscope, you turn this knob until all those lines are coincident, and then you read the angle. Now, when you are reading the angle, you're going to have to do it in phase one and phase two, right? You have to do phase one and phase two because you need to compare the two. In the vertical scale, the phase one and phase two measurements need to add up to 360 degrees. They won't. And this helps you evaluate your index error, is what we call that. If it adds up to more than 360 degrees, you need to take that overage, divide it in half, and subtract that half from the phase one measurement. And there you are. That's what your phase one measurement really should be. If it's less than 360 degrees, you need to take that shortage, divide it in half, and add it to your phase one measurement. That's what your phase one measurement should have been. Okay? Now, as Larry pointed out, I emailed him a little while ago and asked him some questions about this. And he said, well, it doesn't matter if your vertical circle in phase one and phase two has an index error of a minute or 2 minutes or 5 minutes, it doesn't matter. 10 minutes, it doesn't matter. You're going to split that difference and you're going to add or subtract as you need to from the phase one measurement, and there you are. And then to adjust it, if you want that index error to be smaller every time you read, even though he said it really, it's not a big deal. He's like, don't worry about it. I just can't let things go. So I want it as tight as possible. There's a very specific procedure for that, and it's farther down here in the literature. So we're at 6.8 vertical collimation or index error. After the lateral collimation has been corrected and the object is pointed within the horizontal line in both telescope positions, the collimation level is brought to coincidence and the vertical circle is read. Now, that's what I just talked about. That means that bubble, taking two halves of that bubble and you're lining them up. That's what coincidence means. If nothing else, I want you to remember the term coincidence, I guess, from this video. And you read the vertical circle. And then the deviation of the sum of both circle readings of 360 degrees is equivalent to double the index error of the vertical circle. In order to cancel out this error, one computes the zenith distance. And the correct reading is now set on the micrometer scale. And while the horizontal line is still aimed at the object, the graduations of the vertical circle are brought to coincidence by turning the level's tangent screw. The bubble of the collimation level is centered again by loosening one of the adjusting screws with an adjustment pin and slightly tightening the other one. The correction having been made, the index error should be rechecked. So what that's saying is there's two screws on the side of the instrument, which I don't have a picture of. I guess I wasn't prepared. And you adjust, one slightly tightened, the other one slightly loosened, and then you bring that bubble to coincidence, and then you read again. And what you're trying to do is trying to cancel out that error. So suppose you had an error of 5 minutes. So you're 5 minutes short when you add the phase one and phase two measurements. Okay, so what you're doing is you're pointing at the target in phase one. You know what that index error is. And so you're going to turn that micrometer until you got the minutes and seconds where you need them to be. And then you bring the degree lines into coincidence. Let's go and look at that actually. So, so you're going to turn the knob, and when you turn the micrometer knob, you're going to see this change rather rapidly. So you got to change it slowly just to get to the right minutes and seconds. And then you're going to turn that index error knob, I'm not index error, but the index bubble collimation knob until you get the degrees where it's supposed to be. Where these coincide. And then you're going to adjust the bubble up or down, if I'm reading that right. So Larry, you can correct me on that. Or anybody who knows how this works. Remember, this is a learning procedure. I'm really just verbalizing it to make sure I understand it. And you adjust those screws up or down, one loose, one tight, until the two halves of the bubble are in coincidence again. And then you do your phase one and phase two measurement again and check and make sure that, hey, I've either decreased that index error or I've increased it to get it where it belongs. So one of my goals is to go through, take my T2 theodolite and compare it to the TS16 total station, the Leica that I've got. The cool thing is they're both, the center of the scope is both both instruments is the same height above the tribrac, and they both can use tribracs interchangeably. The total station fits in the theodolite's tribrac, and the theodolite fits in the total station's tribrac. They're interchangeable, which is great. So what I can do is I want the theodolite's vertical circle to be closer to where the total station's is at. And so I'm going to set up the total station, aim it at a target, take a phase one, phase two measurement, calculate the zenith distance, and find out what that phase one measurement should have been. Set up my theodolite on the same tribrac. I'm not breaking anything else down. I'm just taking the total station off, put the theodolite on, line up on the exact same target, and collimate the two halves of the bubble. Then look, read the angle, and I want the angle to be as close as possible, the same as the total stations to that target. With that being said, as far as I know, as far as I've been able to determine, the two scopes are the same height above the tribrac. There might be some minor differences that are beyond my ability to measure, and therefore we might be a few seconds off at the end of that process between the two instruments, and that's fine. I'm not going to fight over a few arc seconds. It's minutes that I'm looking for, I think, based on the other day when I set up the theodolite and the auto level. I think I'm looking for minutes of error, not error, but difference between the two. All right. Now I've evaluated my theodolite rather extensively, and I had it out the other day, and I went through. And I turned that vertical circle a few times between a couple targets. And so here I'm calculating the index error, right? So the phase one and the phase two don't quite, well, actually, they add up to more than 360. So I need to subtract 6 seconds from the phase one measurement. And then I found that the mean after all five of these sets was 8609, 10.1 from one to two. And then from two back to one, I found that this was the mean angle between the two. Whoops, got away from myself. Oh, I thought I had a picture of it. My apologies. So I went through this and looked at the standard deviations of both of these both of these setups. And the standard deviation from 1 to 2 ended up being plus or minus 1.3 seconds. I was pretty happy with that. And the standard deviation of 2 back to 1 was 2.0 seconds, plus or minus. And then the standard deviations of the mean for both of those from 1 to 2 was 0, plus or minus 0.6 seconds and plus or minus 0.9 seconds, respectively. So the standard deviation of the mean for both setups was less than a second. Fantastic. And then the standard deviation was 1.3 and 2.0. Now remember what did the Army say when they went through their report? They said at the outset that they found that 90% of the time they were able to get their T2 to operate with an accuracy of plus or minus 2.5 seconds when they did 16 direct and reverse readings. That's phase one and phase two readings during daylight hours, and plus or minus 2.0 seconds during the nighttime. Notice that they did better at night than they did in the day. That's so cool. Less atmospheric interference. I think the nighttime air is a little more consistent, at least over their target area. I think that's pretty awesome. So what I was able to evaluate agrees with what they were doing. I think that's excellent, right? I'm pretty happy with that. All right, so and then there's some interesting things you can get with the T2. There's some additional pieces here. Oh, here's the light setup. Is this the light setup, Larry? You can chime in. It looks like there's an object attached to both the horizontal and vertical circle mirror positions, and there is a wire going into the plug for the light inside there. And it looks like they're reading with power. Maybe I should look into getting these. I have seen these on eBay, these power packs. And I think I actually have the lights themselves. I don't understand how they connect. And then there's a target. So interesting thing. I said Leica had bought out Wild, as far as I know. And what Leica has done is these targets are the same height as the old targets. So this is meant to be the same height off the tri-bracket as the center of the scope of the theodolite, and it's the same with Leica's target system that they have now. It's the same height off the tri-bracket as the center of the scope of the total station. And I think that's power pack for a light target. And then a sub-tense bar. I've wanted to get a sub-tense bar, but golly, they are expensive because they don't make them anymore. If you want one from Wild. It's a sought-after item, and they're kind of expensive. Be fun to have one, and you can have a. Looks like you can have a lit sub-tense bar, as well. And there's other features, other items you can get. Here's the diagonal eyepiece for astronomic observations. This is kind of fun. Jesse sent me a spare set he had, but I can't seem to get it to fit. I'm not getting something about this part of it attaching where they attach. I know how to take the eyepiece off so that this could go in, but I'm missing something, I think. Then a much bigger level to go on there. Other cool features that you can look at. And then, of course, the care and the maintenance and all that, which we looked at. All right, so that's introduction to the Wild T2. I really do look forward to using this more often and getting better at it. So I have a lot to learn. We'll see what happens. as I go along this journey. I invite you to come with me on it. I don't know what my schedule of videos is going to be going forward, but I'll do what I can, and you can look at what I come up with. And again, if you know more about this than I do, which some of you absolutely do, because you had experience with these things, just let me know in the comments and let me know what work you've done with it. Because I think it's pretty cool. I like the idea of using a completely mechanical instrument, because total stations these days are so black box. What the heck is going on inside of that thing? You don't know. that's a joke, of course. But it's fun to have something so mechanical where you can see what's happening. You can see how it operates, see how everything works. And it's a lot of fun. I feel like this kindred spirit with geodetic surveyors from the past decades who use these every day in their work. And I would really, it would have been fun to have been part of those survey parties. Yeah, you're turning the same angle 20, 50, maybe 100 times. I don't know. You're up on a tower, it's nighttime, it's cold, and this is the work that you're doing over and over again. But it's so cool. You're measuring the freaking earth. that's your job. I mean, that's of course my job as well as a land surveyor, but on such a small scale. 100-acre surveys. I've done a little bit of 1,600-acre surveys and whatnot. But I mean, man, this is pretty cool. I like history. I'm kind of a nerd that way. And I hope this hasn't been too boring for you, but I've really enjoyed this video. All right, I'll catch up with you guys later.